Consider that in the history of many worlds, there have always been disposable creatures. They do the dirty work. They do the work that no one else wants to do because it's too difficult or too hazardous. And an army of Data's all disposable. You don't have to think about their welfare. You don't think about how they feel. Whole generations of disposable people.
He's talking about slavery.
I think that's a little harsh.
I don't think that's a little harsh. I think that's the truth. But that's a truth that we have obscured behind a comfortable, easy euphemism.
Who did this to him?
His own government. He's been programmed to be the perfect soldier. He can be absolutely normal, but when a danger is perceived, the programming clicks in and takes over. Memory, strength, intelligence, reflexes, all become enhanced. He's conditioned to survive at any cost.
My improved reflexes have allowed me to kill 84 times. And my improved memory lets me remember each of those 84 faces. Can you understand how that feels?
I am incapable of any feeling.
Why then, I envy you.
You think you have to lie to us and use the white to ensure our loyalty. But the fact is, we are more loyal to the Founders than the Vorta ever will be. It is the reason for our existence.
I have my orders. Heaven doesn't deserve the unwavering loyalty you're giving him.
He does not have to earn my loyalty, Captain. He has had it from the moment I was conceived. I am a Jem'Hadar. He is a Vorta. It is the order of things.
Do you really want to give up your life for the order of things?
It is not my life to give up, Captain. And it never was.
The Vorta's sense of taste is quite limited. About the only foods we really enjoy are kava nuts and ripple berries.
Ah. I take it this is also the result of your genetic programming.
It's the Founder's way of making sure we remember our past.
You're using it as bait to attract the Borg.
He chips on that vessel, isn't he?
He's fighting for his people.
Alone, on an unarmed transport.
We don't have particle weapons or powerful starships at our disposal. We're forced to use the only resource we have.
Your children?
No. Our genetic expertise.
Ichab's not bait. He's a weapon. The first cube that captured him was infected by a pathogen. Ichab was the carrier, wasn't he?
Every time we try to rebuild, begin to make progress, the Borg come and take it away from us.
Tom set a course for that transport vessel full impulse.
Aye, Captain.
You have no right to interfere.
We're trying to save our civilization by taking away Ichab's future. If we don't stop the Borg, the Brunali have no future.
Has it ever occurred to you that the reason you believe the Founders are gods is because that's what they want you to believe? That they built it into your genetic code?
Of course they did. That's what gods do. After all, why be a god if there's no one to worship you?
By the way, I took a tissue sample from the soldier's body. The analysis was rather fascinating in a grim sort of way. It seems the unfortunate soul had been given a massive dose of psychotropic drugs. Why? I'm not sure, but I can tell you one thing. It wasn't to make him amicable. The drug's protein structure seems designed to amplify my people's xenophobic tendencies. My guess is that the soldiers that were left here were part of a Cardassian military experiment. The High Command was probably looking for a way to further motivate their troops.
So they gave them a drug to make them hate anybody but Cardassian.
Captain Jean-Luc Picard, you lead the strongest ship of the Federation fleet. You speak for your people.
I have nothing to say to you. And I will resist you with my last ounce of strength.
Strength is irrelevant. Resistance is futile. We wish to improve ourselves. We will add your biological and technological distinctiveness to our own. Your culture will adapt to service ours.
Impossible. My culture is based on freedom and self-determination.
Freedom is irrelevant. Self-determination is irrelevant. You must comply.
We would rather die.
How long have you been here?
Since they left. A very long time.
A long time to be alone.
Save your compassion. It's revolting. You offer it like a prize when in fact it's an insult.
Because you feel unworthy.
You overrate your gift. You humans are puny, weak.
But our spirit is indomitable.
And still you die from a flick of my power.
Great poet once said, all spirits are enslaved that serve things evil.
You do not understand. I do not serve things evil. I am evil.
Oh, no. You are not.
I am a skin of evil, left here by a race of titans who believed if they rid themselves of me, they would free the bonds of destructiveness.
Yes, so here you are. Feeding on your own loneliness, consumed by your own pain, believing your own lies. You say you are true evil. Shall I tell you what true evil is? It is to submit to you. It is when we surrender our freedom, our dignity, instead of defying you. I'm deeply concerned about what is happening here. It began when we apprehended a spy, a man who admitted his guilt and who will answer for his crime. But the hunt didn't end there. Another man, Mr. Simon Tarsis, was brought to trial, and it was a trial, no matter what others choose to call it. A trial based on insinuation and innuendo. Nothing substantive offered against Mr. Tarsis, much less proven. Mr. Tarsis' grandfather is Romulan. And for that reason, his career now stands in ruins. Have we become so fearful? Have we become so cowardly that we must extinguish a man because he carries the blood of a current enemy? Admiral, let us not condemn Simon Tarsis or anyone else because of their bloodlines, or investigate others for their innocent associations. I implore you, do not continue with this proceeding. End it now. You know, there are some words I've known since I was a schoolboy. With the first link, the chain is forged. The first speech censured, the first thought forbidden, the first freedom denied, chains us all irrevocably. Those words were uttered by Judge Aaron Satie as wisdom and warning. The first time any man's freedom is trodden on, we're all damaged. We think we've come so far. Torture of heretics, burning of witches, all ancient history. Then, before you can blink an eye, suddenly it threatens to start all over again.
I believed her. I helped her. I did not see what she was.
Mr. Worf, villains who twirl their mustaches are easy to spot. Those who clothe themselves in good deeds are well camouflaged.
I think after yesterday, people will not be so ready to trust her.
Maybe. But she or someone like her will always be with us, waiting for the right climate in which to flourish, spreading fear
in the name of righteousness. Vigilance, Mr. Worf. That is the price we have to continually pay.